Well, I'm Marilyn Taniguchi. I'm one of the library managers. We're delighted to welcome you to Jim J's Jukebox special virtual edition. We're so happy that you could join us while we're all observing safer at home guidelines. And just want to point out, we've got a big group of people. It looks like we've already
on video.
50 people. We are going to be recording this program for Jim, as well as the chat. So if you want to not be seen on the video recording, you can way down in the left corner at the bottom, you'll see an icon, or you should see an icon for stop video. You can just click on that and we won't record you. You can also click the microphone next to it. You can click it for mute. But you can also use the chat icon, which is right in the center at the bottom. And that way you can send comments or questions, say thank you, or just say hi to Jim. And the chat will be recorded as well, so he can jump in too. So again, thank you for coming. We will be working with Jim in the spring. Unfortunately, with the library and much of our country still closed, we will likely be doing virtual programs. So we hope it was easy for you to get on, and we hope everything runs smoothly. Thanks again for joining us.
Thank you, Marilyn. Hi, everybody. You know, one of my favorite parts of joining this lecture is saying hello to people before the lecture. And I got to admit, that was a lot of fun. I enjoyed that very much. Almost even better because I'm seeing people from all over this country. I want to thank the library first, by the way. You know, I've been working on this program, and they have done yeoman work in getting the Zoom together. They presented me with this idea, and I must say that that Marilyn and Max and Alice, and now we got a new person, Sandra, have really done great work organizing all of this, getting the flyers out to let you know about it. So it's been a pleasure as always, and thank you very much. Now, I did my last lecture on October 28th. Some of you were there. And I realized after that lecture that I made a little bit of a mistake in terms of timing, because October 28th was about 3 days before Halloween. And that Halloween, which October 31st of 2020, was a Halloween that had a blue moon. A blue moon, as you know, there were two full moons in October. So one of the full moons was on Halloween, so they called it a blue moon. Well, that would have been a perfect time to do moon songs. I could have talked about the Halloween moon and the blue moon on Halloween, it tied right in. And by the way, it doesn't happen that often. The last blue moon on Halloween was 1944, and the next one won't be until 2039. So I don't want to wait that long. So I figure this, if you can do a lecture on the blue moon on Halloween as a point of departure, why not do one on the waxing gibbous, which is 92% illuminated? That's what we have in the skies today, folks. We have the waxing gibbous moon, 92% illuminated. And I'm here to say to you that we're going to do a tribute to that moon with the same moon songs that maybe would have been more appropriate 3 days before the Halloween blue moon. Two blue moon songs, or actually one devil moon song and one blue moon song in commemoration of the gibbous waxing moon, 92% illumination. You can look in the sky and check me on that, folks. Two people by the name of Yip Harburg, lyricist, and Burton Lane, composer, did a musical in 1947 called Finian's Rainbow, one of the great musicals of the American musical canon. They did a film of that 20 years later in 1968. That show, Finian's Rainbow, one of the classics of our Broadway canon, took place at the Richard, at the 46th Street Theater, 46th Street Theater, on 46th Street, as you may have guessed, in New York City. And by the way, apropos of nothing, I will tell you that in Broadway, we have, yes, Oklahoma, okay. And Broadway has 41 theaters. You may find it interesting. You know, there are 41 theaters that qualify as actually Broadway theaters. The first of them, the oldest and still in existence, is the Lyceum Theater, which started in 1903. Now, by the way, digress further, every once in a while, there are name changes to those theaters, so that the 46th Street Theater, in which Finian's Rainbow opened in 1947, is now called the Richard Rogers Theater. And we're going to hear a song by him a little bit later. The Virginia Theater, where I saw The Great City of Angels on 52nd Street, is now called the August Wilson Theater. And I'll digress from a digression. August Wilson is an interesting guy. He's from my hometown of Pittsburgh. And he was a Black playwright who had a dream to write 10 dramatic shows, one in each decade, placed in Pittsburgh through the 20th century. And he did that. He wrote those 10 Broadway shows, all of them made it to Broadway, one for each decade. And the last one, which I think was the decade of the 70s, I'm not sure, he did not do them chronologically. The last one he completed shortly before his death. So he did get that amazing 10 shows done. That theater was named for him shortly after he died. He never got a chance to see that theater in his name. And two other little things about August Wilson, apropos of just telling you things that I feel you'd like to know. Richard Rogers is where Hamlet is playing, and that's correct. There's going to be a stamp commemorating August Wilson in January, which you can look for. And by the way, the other interesting thing is that one of his 10 plays of that great group was called Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, which took place in Pittsburgh, as they all did. And that play has just been made into a movie, which has some talk going on right now for the Academy Awards. I'm very, very eager to see that show. The Henry Miller Theater was changed, by the way, to the Stephen Sondheim Theater, and the 46, as I said, was changed into the Richard Rogers Theater. But I digress. A little bit of history on this show. It was a very, very successful show. It was the first year in 1947 was that they gave an award for a featured actor in a musical, sometimes called a supporting actor. Well, David Wayne, who was in the original cast of Finian's Rainbow, nominated for that award, was the first person to get that award, which is a very interesting piece of history. Other thing, interestingly enough, in 1954, even before they did the movie in 1967 and 68, they wanted to do an animated version of Finian's Rainbow. And they got a lot going on it. They had Sinatra and Ella Fitzgerald and Oscar Peterson and Louis Armstrong to do the music, the voices in those three cases. But here's what was going on. In 1954 was the middle of the Army-McCarthy hearings, which you all know about, maybe some of you even remember. Yip Harburg, as we will talk more about later, was a very staunch advocate for a lot of things left. Now, I'm not going to suggest that he was a communist, but he certainly was a self-identified socialist. There was a lot of concern about that kind of thing at that time. So they dropped the idea of that animated movie because they didn't want to support, the financing blew up because they didn't want to support Yip Harburg because things were pretty bad in those days for people who were confused of left-wing leaning. I'm told that a number of storyboards are still around from that, production design, even some soundtrack. I would love to get a hold of them if I could. Finian's Rainbow had a panoply of hits that have made it into the Great American Songbook. How Are Things in Glockamora became a big hit for Bing Crosby. Look to the Rainbow, wonderful song. If This Isn't Love was from there. And a wonderful novelty song called When I'm Not Near the Girl I Love, I Love the Girl I'm Near. And I just read you one little lyric from that, Yip Harburg was such a genius. Well, they all were geniuses, folks. Listen to this alliteration. Every femme that flutters by me is a flame that must be fanned. But I can't fondle the hand I'm fond of, I fondle the hand at hand. That's Yip Harburg. And the other one, in the bridge of the song, he writes, my heart's in a pickle, it's constantly fickle, it's not to partickle, I fear. That was the great Yip Harburg. Another interesting thing about this show, Columbia Records was considered to be, is considered to be, and is, was, in point of fact, the best record label for original cast albums. There were others. Capitol did good ones, RCA did good ones, Decca, others. But Columbia was the first, and in some ways did the most, and the most highly regarded in all of them. Their very first original cast album was Finian's Rainbow. That was in 1948, no LPs then. They did a six disc, 78 RPM. And then, that was in 1948. And then just a few years later, when the original cast album went to LP, they put Finian's Rainbow from the 78s onto the LP, which became their first LP. So Finian's Rainbow was their first original cast album and their first original cast album on long playing record. Another thing that's interesting, when Sinatra started his own record label in the early 1960s called Reprise, he had a lot of great ideas, manifested a lot of great ideas, and one of them was to get great voices together to record the scores of great Broadway musicals. He got to do four of them before he gave up on the idea, and the four were, you probably can guess one, the four were Kiss Me Kate, South Pacific, Guys and Dolls, and you guessed it, Finian's Rainbow is one of those, and I have that wonderful LP. And he got some of the best voices around him, Bing Crosby, Rosemary Clooney, Joe Stafford, the McGuire Sisters, the Hi-Los, and they were all orchestrated by Nelson Riddle and Marty Page and the great Billy May. So that was a very, very interesting thing. The song you're about to hear is another big hit from Finian's Rainbow called That Old Devil Moon, and you're gonna hear it by the man himself, Frank Sinatra. This song has a very interesting history. Harold Arlen knew Yip Harburg, right, in 1947, because they had done Finian's Wizard of Oz together just a few years earlier. So Yip, they were still friends, went over to Harlan's house in Beverly Hills to play him the score to this new show they were about to do called Finian's Rainbow. Arlen loved it, except for one song, the one song he didn't like at all. And he said, this is no good, you gotta change that. As it turns out, Yip Harburg had in his trunk, the trunk is what songwriters use for songs that they haven't played, they can pull them out and use them again or for the first time. And he had a song called, This Is Where I Came In. This is where I came in. Recognize that melody, the old devil moon. And that was the song, and that was the melody. He pulled that out, kept that same melody, wrote the new lyric to Old Devil Moon, and it became one of the most popular songs in the canon. As a matter of fact, the year that Finian's Rainbow opened, there were two top 10 hits of the song you're about to hear, that Old Devil Moon, one by Margaret Whiting, and the other by Gene Krupa. Yip Harburg was a very interesting guy. He was born in 1896, and he died not far from where I am right now in 1981. As it turns out, he was actually driving along Sunset Boulevard. He suffered a heart attack. His car swerved into the other lane, head-on crash, and he was killed instantly. And the interesting thing about that is the very next day, Yip Harburg was to fly to New York City to get, in 1981, to get the Johnny Mercer Award from the Songwriters Hall of Fame. It was then presented to him posthumously. He was born, as a lot of these guys were, and girls, by the way, Yipsel Harburg on New York's East Side. He actually attended a high school with Ira Gershwin, another great lyricist, and they bonded. First, because they both shared this passion for Gilbert and Sullivan, and then other kinds of things, including both of them writing verse for New York newspapers. Yes, in that period, newspapers actually used to publish light verse, which is really, really terrific. And then he for writing that verse, he began to write for Broadway. And he wrote for reviews in New York at first. And the first one he wrote for was called America, which was 1932. And he wrote a song for that that became the actual anthem for the Depression, which you all know, called Brother, Can You Spare a Dime? This song is an amazing song. I don't think any era could be more summed up in a song than the era of the Depression, was summed up in the song, Brother, Can You Spare a Dime? And I want to show you a little bit about what he did with these great lyrics, and then show you the kind of sense of humor the Parberg had. He wrote, once I built a railroad, made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? And then he writes, once I built a tower to the sun, brick and mortar and lime. Once I built a tower, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? That song is an anthem. But yet Parberg also had a sense of humor about it. He was left wing, as we both acknowledged. And later, because he was concerned about the direction of the country, he wrote this self-parroting lyric. Once we had a Roosevelt, praise the Lord, life had meaning and hope. Now we're stuck with Nixon and a Ford. Brother, can you spare a rope? That's, well, I got somebody laughing here. That's Jim Parberg at his marvelous best. By the way, it's an interesting thing to note that he was working at Paramount at that time. And if you want to believe that all of the great songwriters from New York went out to Hollywood to work in the movies, because that's where the money was after a while, look who he was working with at Paramount Pictures. Harold Arlen, Vernon Duke, who wrote April in Paris, Jerome Kern, the grandfather of the whole thing, Julie Stein, and Burton Lane, with whom he wrote Finnegan's Rainbow. And of course they wrote together with Harlan, the Wizard of Oz. But he was blacklisted, and things didn't work out for a while after that, to say the least. Burton Lane, who wrote the melody for the song you're about to hear, was born Morris Hyland Kushner in 1912. He died 13 years ago in 1997. Burton Lane was a prodigy as a musician. By age 14, he was actually writing songs for off-Broadway shows in New York, particularly a show called the Greenwich Village Follies. And then he did a lot of Broadway with Alan J. Lerner. And Alan J. Lerner, and he did Broadway shows, but he also, when Lerner came out to Hollywood for a while and did a show called Royal Wedding for Fred Astaire. A great ballad from that song called Too Late Now. Well, one day, Alan J. Lerner and Burton Lane were staying at the Bel Air Hotel, and they were driving down to MGM to work on the movie, Royal Wedding. And they wanted a novelty song, and Alan J. Lerner, they're driving down Stone Canyon Drive, we need a comedy song here. Alan J. Lerner said, we need a comedy song here. Something like, how can you believe me when I said I love you when you know I've been a liar all my life? Something like that. And he said, what? Something like that? That is spectacular. And of course, they kept that in. And it's the great novelty song. How can you believe that I said I love you when I know I've been a liar all my life? The other thing interesting about Burton Lane, and there are many other things interesting about him, is he discovered Judy Garland, who at the time was called Frances Gum. She was in a sister act with the Gum Sisters at the Paramount Hollywood Hotel, and she sang a song that later became a big hit for her called Zing Went the Strings of My Heart. Burton Lane called Jack Robbins, who was the music guy at MGM at that time, and said, I got a great singer for you. Robbins respected Burton Lane enough to say, well, bring her over. The next day, they walk into Jack Robbins' office at MGM. Robbins loved this woman, Gum, later to become Judy Garland, called in Louis B. Mayer and said, Louis, you gotta hear this girl. And they literally heard her for about an hour and hired her on the spot in 1937. Interestingly enough, she started to work during that time, but Burton Lane, who discovered her, never had a chance to work with her himself until 1942 because of other commitments. And that's when Burton Lane did for Judy Garland, his protege and the woman he found, quote unquote, did a show called Babes of Broadway in 1942. The song you're about to hear, sung by the man himself, Frank Sinatra, comes from an album he did in 1956 called Songs for Swinging Lovers. This was his fourth album for Capitol, where he went in the early 1950s after having left Columbia, where he was through most of the 1940s. This is right down the middle of Frank Sinatra's golden era, right down the middle of it. This was the first album to ever top the UK charts, which were brand new at that time. It was on the UK charts for a long time, and was knocked off those charts, by the way, by the original cast album for Carousel. And it was a great departure from the album that Sinatra had done just before that, which was called In the Wee Small Hours of the Morning. This was the first album, a sad song of a guy who lost his love. Songs for Swinging Lovers was just what it was, a lot of swinging songs about love songs. It's interesting to me to think about this album, because when we grow up, will there be any music tonight? Yeah, I'll get there. thank you, so much fun. Thank you, Aaron. We think about Frank Sinatra being a legend, and it's interesting that you look back on legends, and it's about Mozart was a legend, or Beethoven was a legend. But those of us who were old enough, even if we started slowly, we saw a legend being born. When Sinatra did his album, his fourth for Capitol, he was becoming a legend. We didn't know it at the time. He was doing one great album after another, after another, after another, but slowly but surely he's all amalgamated into the legend that he is today. So we saw a legend in the making. The song itself is quite wonderful. Yip Harburg has a wonderful triplet there called I Looked at You and Suddenly Something in Your Eyes I See Soon Begins Bewitching Me. That's a nice triplet there. And then it's that old devil moon that you stole from the skies, that old devil moon in your eyes. And then he's got an internal rhyme, you and your glance make this romance too hot to handle. Stars in the night blazing their light can't hold a candle. And then one more triplet I want to point out, you've got me flying high and wide on a magic carpet ride full of butterflies inside. And then the song becomes very intense when he says, I want to cry, want to croon, want to laugh like a loon. And it goes on from there. And then this song has a coda. Just when you think it's over, Yip has Frank saying, just when I think I'm free as a dove, the old devil moon deep in your eyes blinds me with love. The song itself is a tour de force. Notice at the beginning there's a suspension. You know, to me, music, even though it's intellectual, it's also tactile. And you can hear the suspension. I look to you suddenly, somebody else sees me, it's suspended. And you know, even if you're not a musician, you know that that suspension has to have a release. It cannot possibly stay up there indefinitely. It's not going to work. And sure enough, Frank Sinatra doesn't take a breath, and I'll point that out to you, and he goes right into it, that old devil moon, and then you hear it swing right along. Notice a couple other times, full of butterflies inside, where Sinatra does not take a breath. I want to say something about, when you hear him not take a breath, it will seem normal to you. But when he did that, 1956 and before, it was literally a revolution, breathing in a whole different way, changing the tempo and the dynamics of a song, always staying on the beat and getting where he had to get to by the time he had to get there, but still fooling around with that beat in the middle. Absolute revolution. The instrumental bridges is magnificent. By Nelson Riddle. When I go like this, it means there's syncopation going in there and punches that are really great. And you're going to hear a muted trumpet in this song. That is by the great Harry Edison, sometimes called Harry Sweets Edison. And by the way, what we've done, Sweetie Pie put this together, we have photographs behind. We don't have, when I do at the library, we don't have pictures because we can kind of relate to the audience. But here, the pictures seem to make a sense. It's not really a music video, but the pictures that we've chosen are just to exemplify the things that I've talked about here. So you're going to see the 46th Street Theater, for example. And one other thing I forgot to mention, you'll see it here. When Sinatra did the original album cover for the album, Swinging Lovers, the lovers were in the front, and he was looking away from the lovers. And you're going to see that original album cover. And then they changed it, exactly the same cover, the same idea, the same two lovers, but He's now looking down at them, not looking down at them emotionally, but looking down at them spatially in that new version. So you will find that interesting. I found it interesting, so I'm assuming you will find it interesting. So here we go. This is the great Frank Sinatra, Yip Harburg, and the lyric, and Burton Lane, That Old Devil Moon.
I look at you and suddenly something in your eyes I see soon begins bewitching me. It's that old devil moon that you stole from the skies. It's that old devil moon in your eyes. You and your glance make this romance too hot to handle. Stars in the night blazing their light can't hold a candle to your razzle-dazzle. You got me flying high and wide on a magic carpet ride full of butterflies inside. Wanna cry, wanna croon, wanna laugh like a loon. It's that old devil moon in your eyes. Just when I think I'm free as a dove, old devil moon deep in your eyes blinds me with love. Me flying high and wide on a magic carpet ride full of butterflies inside. Wanna cry, wanna croon, wanna laugh like a loon. It's that old devil moon in your eyes. Just when I think I'm free as a dove, old devil moon deep in your eyes blinds me with love. How it blinds me with love.
Yeah, Frank Sinatra. Rodgers and Hart, as we all know, had a great number of hits, but all but one of them came from Broadway and from Hollywood. And it turns out that the one that didn't come from Hollywood or didn't come from Broadway is the biggest hit song that they ever had. It's called Blue Moon. But it didn't start out that way. And that song was a very long time coming. During the Depression, when things were bad in New York, a lot of people, including Rogers and Hart, moved to California to make money doing music for Hollywood. They came out and went to work for MGM. And by the way, at that time, MGM was run by a guy named Howard Dietz, who interestingly enough was a big promotion guy, but also a great songwriter on his own. He wrote a song called Dancing in the Dark. He also was the guy, Howard Dietz, who wrote Dancing in the Dark and was head of everything at MGM for a while, was actually the one who came up with the Lion logo for MGM. And then he added the arts for art's sake in Latin to keep it a little more exciting. Howard Dietz wanted a screwball comedy to go on. Are we still okay here, honey? He wanted a screwball comedy. There was a movie with Howard with Gene Harlow, and he wanted a screwball song to go well along with that screwball comedy. So he went to Rogers and Hart and said, you got to write, you know, this kind of screwball song. And they wrote a song that goes like this. Oh Lord, if you ain't busy up there, I ask for help with a prayer, so please don't give me the air. Well, that was the melody to Blue Moon, as you may have noticed. As it turns out, that melody never saw the light of day at that point, nor did that lyric by Larry Hart, because that movie never happened as planned, and it went the way of all flesh, and they put that song, as we now know, into their trunk. A couple of years later, Howard Dietz wanted to do a movie called Manhattan Melodrama. They wanted a title song that exemplified the title Manhattan Melodrama. And Dietz went to Rogers and Hart and said, we need a title song for a movie called Manhattan Melodrama. And so they brought out that old melody that became Blue Moon at some point, and they wrote Act One, you gulp your coffee and run into the subway, you crowd. Don't breathe, it isn't allowed. Act Two, the boss is yelling at you. You feel so frightened and cowed. Don't breathe, it isn't allowed. Now, you've never heard that because that song never happened either. They scuttled the title song. We don't need a title song for this movie, they finally said. So that song was scuttled. But they said to Richards and Rogers and Larry Hart, we do need a smoky ballad. We need a smoky ballad for this woman to sing late in the movie. So they take that same melody out the third time, and they write a smoky love ballad for this woman who was called Shirley Ross. Now she's singing in the melody, oh Lord, what is the matter with me? I'm not permitted to see the bad in every man. Oh Lord, I could be good to a lover, but then I always discover the bad in every man. That's the third iteration of that Blue Moon melody, which did find its way into that movie. That movie, interestingly enough, I find it, was the one movie playing at the Biograph Theater in Chicago. And the movie that John Dillinger saw is one of the last things he ever did, because he walked out of that screening of Manhattan Melodrama and into that alley behind the theater and was gunned down. And one other thing, by the way, apropos of nothing, Shirley Ross, who sang that version of the Blue Moon melody in the movie Manhattan Melodrama, playing the Biograph Theater, is that right? She was the woman who sang the song Thanks for the Memory in big broadcast in 1939. Bob Hope first heard that song there, loved it so much that he adopted it as his theme song. That was in 1939. Well, at the end of all of that, the song wouldn't die, because the publicity guy for MGM came to Rogers Hart and said, look, that is an unbelievable melody. I mean, that melody is so commercial that if we can put a commercial lyric onto that song, and a really commercial lyric onto that song, we can sell a million copies. And Larry Hart didn't really like that idea because he wasn't a particularly commercial guy. He was a little bit too erudite for that. And he used to call them Moon June song. Oh, you want a Moon June song, you know, Moon June Spoon, all that stuff. That it wasn't where he was. But they were convinced that money talked a little bit. And so in 1934, they wrote Blue Moon, the fourth lyric that they wrote for that incredible Richard Rogers melody. And it turns out that MGM was right, that became a massive hit in 1935. The Glenn Gray Casaloma Orchestra had a number one hit with their rendition of Blue Moon. And in the same year, Benny Goodman had a number five hit and Ray Noble had a number five hit. So that the instinct of that fellow at MGM was fantastic because it had three top 10 hits in the first year. It also became the theme song for a great radio show at the time called Hollywood Hotel. Then the song, for some reason, fell out of favor in the cabaret circle, and it was out of favor really for a long time until 1961. In 1961, there was a Pittsburgh doo-wop group called the Marcells, and I'm going to tell you in a minute how the Marcells got their name. They were overshadowed at the time by a very prominent Pittsburgh doo-wop group called Jimmy Beaumont and the Skyliners. They were the number one out of Pittsburgh. And by the way, in those days, there were a lot more regional music than there is today. And there were a lot of regional music in Cleveland, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, Baltimore, all that kind of stuff. So they wanted to do a recording session with them. But because they were kind of second stringers compared to Jimmy and the Beaumont, they said, we can only give you so much time. So they walked in to the recording studio in 1961, and they recorded three songs. And they didn't really like the fourth song, but they wanted to get four songs to do an EP, right? They needed four songs. So they only had 70 minutes. They had 70 minutes left. And they said, you know anything else? Well, all of a sudden they said, we know a song called Blue Moon. Most of the guys in the Marcells didn't know Blue Moon, but some of them did. Well, lo and behold, they spent literally almost 60 minutes of their hour learning the song, learning Blue Moon. They do the arrangement, and they only had 10 minutes to record two takes. They recorded two takes of that song. The first one was good. They said, let's try it again. We got a couple of minutes left. They recorded the second time. It turns out that the first one was the better of the two, and they became a big number one hit with that first version of Blue Moon, which they learned in 1 hour and recorded in part of 10 minutes. One of the reasons that song became a hit was that they gave it to Murray the K. Are we okay here?
Why does green show someone else?
I don't know. I'll keep talking and hope they can see me. They gave it to Murray K. And he loved it so much, he played the song 26 times. We can see you. Thank you, Aaron. Okay, thank you. I can't see me, but you can see me. That's what counts. They played 26 times. After that, it became the number one hit. In April of 61, that song knocked Elvis Presley off the charts. And 2 months later, became the number one song in Great Britain. The Marcells were formed in 1959 in the great town of Pittsburgh, my hometown. At first they were a mixed group, five guys, two white, three black. They then started to tour in the South. And at that time, even as late as 1961, they weren't accepting mixed groups in the South, so they replaced the two white guys with two black guys, and it made it okay. Fred Johnson was the bass singer for this group, and by the way, that's a big deal. You know, the bass singer is a big deal in doo-wop, as you will hear when you hear this wonderful version of Blue Moon. She came up with the name. At the time, there was something called the Marcel Wave. It was a guy, Francois Marcel, invented this wave, and he actually invented a special kind of curling iron to make the wave. It was the Marcel Wave. And it was his sister who said, yeah, we should do call ourselves the Marcells. And so they did after the world famous Marcel Wave. After that, the Marcells did a lot of standards like Blue Moon in the doo-wop style, Heartaches, My Melancholy Baby, even Over the Rainbow, Summertime. None of them worked as well as Blue Moon. And Blue Moon, by the way, this version of it is in the Cleveland Rock and Roll Museum as one of the 500 songs that shaped rock and roll. The group finally split, by the way, only 25 years ago in 1995. They reunited in 1999 for a PBS doo-wop special called Doo-Wop 50 Years. They were in two movies, Twist Around the Clock in 1961 and Bikini Beach with Annette Funicello and Frankie Avalon in 1964. Now, I just got to tell you this. The Marcel Wave was established in the 1920s. And it became very, very popular after that. They use it even in movies. Al Dubin and Harry Warren wrote a song called Keep Young and Beautiful, Keep Young and Beautiful. It was used in an Eddie Cantor movie called Roman Scandals in 1933. And they wrote this song that went something like this. If you're wise, exercise the fat off, take it off out of here, out of there. When you're seen anywhere with your hat off, wear a Marcel Wave in your hair. So that's how popular that Marcel Wave was. Blue Moon. Well, this is a simple song, but a great song. And of course the doo-wop arrangement is just fantastic. Blue Moon, you saw me standing alone without a love of my own, without a love in my heart. And then you'll see a female rhyme here. I like to point that out. A female rhyme is when the rhyme is on the next to last syllable instead of the last syllable. And he has, you knew just what I was there for. You heard me saying a prayer for someone I really could care for. Three successive female rhymes. And it goes on from there. Notice the bass voice when you hear this. And notice, by the way, that in this song, the guy's praying for love. And because it's a little Hollywood story, even in about 55 words, his prayers are answered. I want to tell you something very interesting about the opening of this song in a second. Notice the bass voice in this song. I say that people who sing like the guys you're about to hear do not have blood in their veins, folks. There is no blood there. There is only music. There can only be music. For this music, much music to come out of people, they have to have a pursing through their veins. It's absolutely amazing to me. And notice the high voices and the low voices. This is quintessential doo-wop. I defy you to try to stand still when you're listening to this. I don't think you can do it. And notice the big bass voice at the end of this. Now, here's something interesting. The distinguished featuring, and one of the distinguishing features of this song is the opening, doo-wop, doo-wop, bang, 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 bang. Well, that was almost an accident. They were recording the song and they were trying to figure out how to get this done, right? They were putting this together at that last minute. And one of the people there remembered that there was a group called the Collegians who had done something different. And let me play you now what the Collegians did first, if you can play that, honey. And listen to what the Collegians do first, and then you'll hear something very interesting. Listen just to the beginning of this song called Zoom, Zoom, Zoom by the Collegians. So one of the people at that last minute during that hour remembered that beginning. And when you hear the beginning of Blue Moon, I think you could probably already figure what you're about to hear, you will know that it was literally picked up at the last minute and stolen from what the Collegians had done in Zoom, Zoom, Zoom. So here is the one song that didn't come from a movie or a Hollywood show or a Broadway show from Roger and Hart, which became their biggest hit, The Great Marcells from Pittsburgh.
Bom 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 dang 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 ding dong ding blue moon 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 blue moon dip 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 moon 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 blue moon dip 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 bomb 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 dang 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 ding and on the moon.
You saw me standing alone without a dream in my heart.
Bomb, dang it, dang, dang, ding it, on
the blue moon. You knew just what I was there for. You heard me saying a prayer for someone I really didn't care for. And then they suddenly appeared before me, the only one my heart could ever hold.
Bomb, dang it, dang, dang, ding it, on, ding, boom. Bomb, 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 dang it, dang, dang, ding it, on, ding, boom.
Yeah. Virtually everything that you hear in popular music is a love song, and I'm about to prove that to you. In 1974, they were developing a one act musicals, hopefully for Broadway, in Canada with a lot of Canadian people, starring Doug Henning, the great Canadian magician, called Spellbound. Nothing was really working, but they still felt they could bring it to New York. So they took the idea for Spellbound and Doug Henning to New York and changed everything else except the idea and Doug Henning. They got a new director, they got a new choreographer, they got a new set designer, they got a new book writer, they got a new everything, including bringing in the great Stephen Schwartz to write the music and lyrics. They renamed it The Magic Show, and it became a big Broadway hit in 1975. Stephen Schwartz is a big man right now because he does a lot of things for Disney, which are popular, and he wrote the music and lyrics to Wicked, which has been running in New York forever. He was one of two people to ever have three Broadway musicals written by him, music and lyrics, running at the same time. They were Pippin, Magic Show, which you're about to hear a song from, and Godspell. That was in mid-1974. The other person that had three Broadway musicals for which he wrote both the music and the lyrics running at the same time was the great Jerry Herman, who in early 1969 had Hello Dolly and Mame and La Cage aux Folles, two great geniuses. Stephen Schwartz has won three Oscars, three Grammys, four Drama Desk Awards, one Golden Globe, and one Tony. Magic Show is very different than Wicked, which is, by the way, ran for 6,836 performances when it was shut down on or about March 11th. I presume it will be back. I know it will be back. But he did a lot of things besides that. He did the lyrics for a show called Mass, with music by none other than Leonard Bernstein, which opened at the Kennedy Center. And he did a show called Pippin, in 1972. And that show is interesting for a lot of reasons, musically, but it's also interesting because it was the first show ever in New York to use local television commercials to promote the shows. There was a newspaper strike on at the time. They were desperate on what to do. And they said, let's give it a try. Let's try television. Well, they were using television to promote those shows ever since. One of the shows I'm going to mention that we're going to be doing with our new theater company in New York, J2 Spotlight, along with the great Rob Schneider, our artistic director, is called The Baker's Wife, one of the great unsung scores, unsung metaphorically speaking, of all time, which we're very, very, very excited about. And I am told Stephen Schwartz is also excited about having that great musical revisited. He also did a show called Working, which is based on a really interesting Studs Terkel book of the same name. And for Disney, he wrote The Prince of Egypt, Pocahontas, and Hunchback of Notre Dame. He is quite the guy, to say the least. Somebody once went to Irving Berlin and said, Irving, how do you write a lyric? And Irving Berlin said, all you gotta do is find a new way to say I love you. And that's very true. They have creative ways to say it. Now, interestingly enough, there are 700 songs copyrighted by ASCAP and BMI called I Love You, because you can't copyright a title, 700. But there are thousands, tens of thousands of songs that manage to say I love you in a more circumspect way. And you're about to hear a quintessential example of that in a few minutes. Love songs. It's about having love, losing love, regaining love, unrequited love, imagine love, all the kinds of love you can possibly imagine. One of the most poignant things to express in the idea of love is the idea of longing for love so much, wanting love more than anything. As a matter of fact, in most Broadway musicals, there's something called a wanting song, which is sung by the ingenue early on. And the wanting song almost inevitably is about wanting love. If someday my prince will come, somebody somewhere loves me and needs me, all of those great wanting songs at the beginning of a show. This is a wanting song, an extraordinary longing wanting song in its own way, and so marvelously and inventively creative. I once heard this song. I have to say this because it was a moment in my life, because the song, you know, is so brilliant. If you get the idea of this song, there was a woman that I knew. She was a performer in town. She's still around. We've gotten out of touch. Her name is Melissa Fawn. And I was sitting in the front row. They were doing a backers audition for what was going to be a new Stephen Schwartz musical. And she sang this song, which is called The Lion Tamer. Yes, The Lion Tamer is a love song, folks. And she was getting into the song so creatively and so knowingly that I felt I could see the creative energy coming out of the top of her head. I could see it. I swear somehow I could see it. I could feel the idea that she understood this song and was able to convey what it was that was going on. You're not going to hear it by Melissa Fawn. I don't know that she ever recorded this song. You're going to hear it by Kristen Chenoweth, a little more prominent person. She was in the original cast of Wicked. She played Glinda. She was born in Oklahoma. She was adopted at age 5, and only later she met her biological parents, by the way, and learned that she is one quarter Native American, one quarter Cherokee, as it turns out. She also was a big star with Charlie Brown in New York. She did situation comedy, but that didn't really work as hell. It looks like, well, for her, it looks like her medium is definitely musical theater. This song comes with a lion tamer. This takes place in a circus in the show, and this little girl, this young girl, is not getting the attention she wants from somebody in the company. And she starts to muse about what she might be able to do to get the attention of this person. And as this song goes through its evolution, you're gonna say, where's the love, where's the love? Well, it's all building up to the love. It's all about the love. It's the whole thing for the first 5 or 6 verses, of course, is about love and getting to it. One of the things that I miss about Broadway these days, one of the things I miss about Broadway from the Golden Age, is overtures. We used to have wonderful overtures. We don't have them as much anymore. I miss them very much. I think not only they were, it was so exciting when you heard all the melodies of the songs you were about to hear. And by the way, you got familiar with the songs, so when you heard them in the show, you know, they became a little more palatable to you. But anyway, bring back overtures, please. This song, in a way, has its own overture. There's such an opening, the French horn in the opening, it's a fairly long opening, and you're going to feel the idea of the song. You're going to get the rhythm, you're going to get the harmony, you're going to get the chord structure, you get the key changes, all within the first several measures of this song, punctuated by a magnificent French horn and a celeste. At one point, she says, everyone has a special calling, something only he can do. I could be such a lion tamer. I love little words. I could be such a lion tamer. The word such, that is a very juvenile word, very juvenile. I could be such a lion tamer. That is not a mature person longing. That is a young, immature person longing. And it's just, to me, I mean, language is almost a magnificent music. And that one word that Schwartz put in there, I could be such a lion tamer, works absolute wonders. And then at one point, she says, I could begin with baby leopards, move on to tiger cubs, and then, after I learned to handle lions, maybe I could work up to men. Well, now we're getting a clue. And then she says, in reverse, what she doesn't want, saying, what I really want is love. I never wanted fancy mansions, butlers and footmen liveried. I never wanted lots of money. And then a brilliant line, money can't buy what you really need. Money can't buy what you really need. How brilliant is that? And then it goes into the real love aspects of the song. I'm not going to tell you about that. I'm going to let Christian Chenoweth tell you about that. I love the idea of longing. I want to play you just one line about longing. This is a song from a Broadway musical called Plain and Fancy, which took place in Pennsylvania. It was set in the Amish country near Lancaster County. And this song is called This Is All Very New to Me. And at one point in this song, Barbara Cook, the ingenue, says something very, very simple. What to do, what to say, how to make it go on this way. Just that, what to do, what to say, how to make it go on this way. There is so much longing in that, that this one line just encapsulated. I just wanna play this one little line for you to get you set up for what longing for love can be and how it can be beautifully expressed.
What to do? What to say, how to make it go on this way.
Just that, folks, just that. You can hear the whole song if you want to, but just that will tell you everything you need to know about longing. As a matter of fact, if you get in the right kind of mood, the longing about this can actually make you cry. So here I leave you with the inestimable Stephen Schwartz, Kristen Plenoweth, and a love song from the magic show called Lion Tamer. By the way, it's a slow song, folks. I suspect that most of you have not heard it. So just let it sweep over you, get into it. And I think as it progresses, you will see the glory of this amazing song. Here we go.
To be a lion tamer, sequins and tights and silk top hats. I know I could be a lion tamer. I've always gotten along with cats. I'd have a whip but never use it. I'd simply hold it in my hand. I'd like to be a never could stand on my toes. I couldn't be a Spanish dancer. I'd look ridiculous with a rose. But everyone has a special calling, something that only he can do. I could be such a lion tamer if I could be a lion tamer. I would be special too. I could begin with baby leopards, move on to tiger cubs, and then after I learn to handle lions, maybe I could work up to men. I never wanted fancy mansions, butlers and footmen liveried. I never wanted lots of money. Money can't buy what you really need. I never prayed for any favors, but here I am on a beanie. Please let me be a lion. A lion tamer, wouldn't he have to finally notice me?
I have one more song for you tonight, folks. I will tell you first, however, that we are going to do three of these in what we call our spring series under the auspices of the Beverly Hills Public Library. They will be all on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. Los Angeles time, February 10th, March 17th, and April 28th. And you'll be getting information from the library in the mail about that. And you will be getting information from me through email about that. Thank you very much, Susan. I agree with you. And I think I look forward to seeing you then. I also have to acknowledge Sweetie Pie, honey. this is my partner here, AJ. Many of you know her. She helps me set up all this music. She organizes the photographs that we pick. As a matter of fact, you're about to see something. There's a song called Violets for Your Furs, which we're about to play, and I have to say, so we're on pictures. So I found a picture of violets, and I found a picture of furs, but I didn't have anything with violets and on furs, so all of a sudden it materializes. She has like become a production manager excellence, and you're right, Jake. She does have a beautiful voice. So thank you, honey. Couldn't do it without you.
Yeah, and maybe you can chat with people after.
Yeah, and if you want to chat with me after this is over, they're going to leave chat on for a couple minutes. If you want to say hello or anything. But I do have one more song. You're not saying goodbye, are you, Marilyn? We have one more song.
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely, Jim.
Okay, thanks, Marilyn. I thought you were signing off there. Okay, well, it's December, folks. Most of you live in Southern California. For those of you who live in Pittsburgh, it may be, or Philadelphia, it may be a little chilly. You may even have snow. And sometimes I think, since I moved to Los Angeles, we get we feel deprived out here because we don't have the coziness of winter, you know, where we can have fireplaces and mulled cider and mittens and go like this all the time and pretend that it's really cold, get that December feeling. And I'm going to play you a song that gives you a very, very winter feeling. It's not a Christmas song, but it will feel like a Christmas song, I think, when you hear it. This song was written by a fellow named Matt Dennis. Some of you have probably heard of Matt Dennis. If you haven't, you're about to. Matt Dennis, genius, another genius, they're all geniuses, was born in Seattle. In 1914, died in Riverside, not too far from here, in 2002. He came from a musical family. They had a vaudeville act called the Five Musical Lovelands. That was his mother and father and a few other people. But he was a young, talented guy. By 1933, he wasn't even 20 years old at that point, he was playing the piano and singing for the great Horace Hype Orchestra. And then he had his own band. And you know who he hired for a singer for his own band? Dick Haymes, who later became a great competitor to Frank Sinatra in the 1940s. He was so good that he also became a vocal coach on the side. And one of the groups that he vocally coached were the Stafford Singers, which included Joe Stafford. And so Joe Stafford learned to like and love and respect him. And so she went to her boss, Tommy Dorsey, and said, hey, you got to hire this guy to be an arranger for you and a composer because he's really got a lot of talent. Tommy Dorsey respected Joe Stafford. He said, yes, I will do that, or at least check it. And for Tommy Dorsey, Frank records, Matt Dennis writes, and Frank records, everything happens to me. The night we called it a day, let's get away from it all. And the song you're about to hear, Violets for Your Furs. And by the way, let's get away from it all. I find this really interesting. This is something I wonder what they're doing these days. Let's get away from it all, right? Which Frank recorded on his album called Come Fly With Me. And one of the lyrics in there that Frank sings, because it was that way at the time, we'll travel around from town to town, we'll visit every state. I'll repeat, I love you, sweet, in all the 48. So my question always is, what are we going to rhyme with 50? And then there's one little rhyme in there I want to tell you about. Let's take a kayak to Quincy or Nyack. I don't think anybody ever rhymed Nyack and kayak before. He also did a song called Angel Eyes. Angel Eyes, which is very important for Frank Sinatra. I don't know if you ever saw Frank Sinatra. I saw him 100 times, which was not as many as I would have liked. And he always had something called a saloon section. He loved doing this. And he would stop everything. He'd get a bourbon or a Jack Daniels, whatever he drank, and a cigarette and sit down on a stool. And he loved setting this up. It was just always part of his act. And he said he loved the idea. You know, you're a guy, the left, he used to say, the chick is blown, the chick is gone, the chick is gone. And you're dying, you're sad, you're crying, you wanna kill yourself. And he loved that feeling. And so he always had this a group of songs that he used in that segment. One of them, was The Gal That Got Away, the very famous Gal That Got Away. Guess I'll Hang My Tears Out to Dry was another one. One for My Baby, One for the Road, In the Wee Small Hours of the Morning. And the one that Matt Dennis wrote, which is called Angel Highs. And if you ever saw Frank Sinatra, I guarantee you, you will remember that he did that segment. Matt Dennis wrote the song you're about to hear with a guy named Tom Adair, A-D-A-I-R. He was born in Kansas City in 1913, died in Honolulu in 1984. He moved to LA with his family shortly after he grew up, and he became, are you ready for this? A customer service guy at the complaint desk for DWP in Los Angeles. the Department of Water and Power, folks. The guy who was able to write the lyric you're about to hear was actually handling complaint calls for the Department of Water and Power in Los Angeles. I mean, this was, but in his spare time, he was doing what he really loved, which was to play and sing and write poetry and music. It got started really with Dennis, because Dennis was playing the piano at a gin mill in Los Angeles. Adair went there to listen to him play. And he got to know Adair a little bit. And he said, I got a great lyric for you. I got a great title. No, not lyric. I got a great title. Will You Still Be Mine? That was all I had. Will You Still Be Mine? Now, Ira Gershwin said, a title is vital. In other words, he was saying that it's the idea of the song first that matters. Then you got to put a good lyric to that song, but you first got to come up with the idea. What is the concept? And then his concept was, Will You Still Be Mine? And Dennis liked it very, very much. And the rest is history. And by the way, Tom Adair was a great wordsmith. He wrote scripts for the F Troop, for Gomer Pyle, My Three Sons, My Favorite Martian. And he worked at Disney shortly after, just before I got there. He wrote songs for Disneyland. He wrote songs for the Mickey Mouse Club. And he wrote the theme song for Disney's Zorro. So this guy was quite active. Did one Broadway show with Gordon Jenkins. Gordon Jenkins called Along Fifth Avenue, Jackie Gleason in 1949. This musical is so forgotten. It is so forgotten, you can't even find it on Google. Now, when you can't find something on Google that starred Jackie Gleason, you know we're in for major obscurity. So by the way, those songs that he recorded for Tommy Dorsey, Frank, when he started at Capitol 10 years later in the early 1950s, he recorded all those songs again within the first 4 or 5 years. The first album that Sinatra did at Capitol was called Songs for Young Lovers. Now, at this point, Frank has made his comeback. Don't forget, late 1940s, 1950, 51, Frank was out. He had lost his contract with MGM. He had lost his contract with Capitol Records, with the Columbia Records. He was nowhere. As far as everybody was concerned, he was washed up. Nobody was answering his phone anymore. I mean, it's hard to imagine, but he was zero zippo. And then he got the role of Maggio for From Here We Turn. He got the Academy Award, got a great new contract deal with Capitol Records, which became the greatest 10-year period of his life. And before you know it, by 1954, he was back on top. And in 1954, Billboard, which was the consummate poll for music in that time, favorite male singer of 1954, Frank Sinatra. Favorite song of 1954, Young at Heart by Frank Sinatra. Favorite album of 1954, Swing Easy by Frank Sinatra. So he came back and never left until he died some years later, much too early as far as I'm concerned. He did two small albums. One was called Swing Easy, and the other was called Songs for Young Lovers. They had 8 songs each. They were combined into an album called Swing Easy with 16 songs. The song you're about to hear was recorded on May 2nd, 1953 at the KHJ radio studio, which is at 5515 Melrose Avenue. You can drive past there if you live in LA, and you can see Frank Sinatra walking in that door to record this song. Amazing to me. And those were all the recordings he did there were A Foggy Day, My Funny Valentine, They Can't Take That Away From Me, and Violets for Your Furs, which you're about to hear. All orchestrated by Nelson Riddle, all recorded in early May of 1953. And by the way, it was an interesting thing. Frank wasn't too happy about all of this, because the great Billy May was supposed to be the arranger for this album. But Billy May was induced by Capitol to form a big band, Billy May Big Band. And so he said, okay, I'll do it. Had to go on the road and give up his recording gig. They brought in Nelson Riddle. And Frank said, who in the hell is this guy? He wasn't known at that time. And they had a little bit of a problem at first. And there's this great story during this recording session in May 2nd of 1953 that they leave, and all the musicians are there, and Frank takes Nelson Riddle on the other side of the glass. And nobody can hear what they're saying. And Frank is going like this and talking and saying, not angry, not upset, but you can see he's lecturing. And he's trying to say, this is what I need, this is what I want to Riddle. Because Frank knew exactly what he wanted. Well, it turns out that all he was saying to Nelson Riddle was, look, he says, I know you want to cook. I know you want to do big things with the orchestra. I love that. That's fine with me. But stay out of my way. Make it as big as you want. Open, close, instrumental, bridge, do whatever you want. Let them cook. I love these guys. I grew up with the big bands. But when I'm singing, I don't want a lot of stuff. I want to be out there with a complimentary background, but I don't want you to overwhelm. It wasn't an ego thing at all. He just knew that when he was the guy, let him be out there and let the orchestra shine when it's their turn. Well, needless to say, Nelson Riddle got that. And the rest is history. By the way, when Sinatra was coming back, he used to play at the place called 500 Club in Atlantic City. Oh my God, named Skinny D'Amato. And that's the first time I saw Frank. I think it was 1960, I'm not sure. And I still remember that day driving down all by myself to go see Frank Sinatra. And then I saw him 99 times after that, and the rest is history. Violets for Your Furs is an amazing song, amazing idea for a song, first. It has a verse. A verse is a wonderful thing. It's kind of a prologue to the song, and then you can hear the song. And there's something in here. It was winter in Manhattan. It's falling snow. You know what this is? This is a tone poem. It's actually a tone poem. It was winter in Manhattan. Falling snowflakes filled the air. The streets were covered with a film of ice. But it's simpler than magic that I learned about somewhere. Change the weather all around, just within a trice. Now, trice, how many people have used the word trice in the last year? I'll bet you if I could see you, not one hand went up. Trice means very soon, it means a short time. And I'm having fun with this word because we like the language. You can say it in a more informal way, ASAP, in a jiffy, two shakes of a lamb's tail, the twinkling of an eye, or pronto. You could use a dated way to say trice, anon, or you could use a formal way to say trice, forthwith. Adair used none of them. He used trice. And by the way, not only is it a wonderful word, but I should point out to you, it rhymes with ice. So that works really well. Then, wonderful lyric, I brought you violets for your furs, and it was spring for a while, remember? I brought you violets for your furs, and there was April in that December. And then some more marvelously descriptive language. The snow drifted down on the flowers, and it melted where it lay. The snow looked like dew on the blossoms as on a summer day. I brought you violets for your furs, and there was blue in the wintry sky. You pinned my violets to your furs, love this, and gave a lift to the crowds passing by. And then the denouement, you smiled at me so sweetly. Since then, just one thought occurs, that we fell in love completely the day that I brought you violets for your furs. It is really wonderful. They say that a picture is worth a thousand words. I say that these words are worth a thousand pictures, because that's how I feel. The reason I read those to you, because now I want you to hear what Frank Sinatra does with this remarkable lyric. It's a very interesting song structure, by the way. You know, most songs are structured A-A-B-A. This is A-B-A, and then a coda, which is C. Couple things I want to mention. Interestingly to note, when Frank recorded this song, he was 38 years old. And notice this song, even early, 1953, had all of the Frank Sinatra characteristics. He had suspension. You'll hear Fill the Air suspension. A lot of bending of notes, holding of notes, sustaining of notes. The snow drifted down on the flower. You can feel the falling. So he just gets all these word pictures. You're going to hear a nice violin in here. That is the great Felix Slatkin. who was great, even though he died at age 48. Felix Flatkin is here, bending, elongating, and you're going to hear strings coming in after the first two choruses, the first time you will hear strings. I think you're going to like this. If you live in a cold place, it'll make you feel colder. If you live in a warmer place, then maybe you can feel like you're getting just a little bit of winter. So I will leave you with this. If you want to chat a little bit after this is over, my formal presentation is done for the evening. I look forward to seeing you in the new year. So now I leave you with the great Matt Dennis, Nelson Riddle, Frank Sinatra, Tom Adair, and the great Violets for Your Furs, and Happy Hanukkah, Merry Christmas, and Happy New Year to everybody. Here we go.
It was winter in Manhattan, falling snowflakes filled the air. The streets were covered with a film of ice. But a little simple magic that I'd heard about somewhere changed the weather all around just within a trice. I bought you violets for your furs, and it was spring for a while, remember? I bought you violets for your furs, and there was April in that December. The snow drifted down on the flowers, and it melted where it lay. The snow looked like dew on the blossoms as on a summer day. I bought you violets for your furs, and there was blue in the wintry sky. Then you pinned the violets to your furs and gave a lift to the crowds passing by. You smiled at me so sweetly. Since then, one thought occurred, that we fell in love completely the day that I bought you violets for your furs.